Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Blaze Christian Fellowship. We're glad you're all here with us this morning. Let's bow our heads and hearts in prayer as we start today's service. Lord God, we just come before you. We thank you, Lord, for another day, Lord. And we just thank you for us being able to gather, Lord, in your name, Lord, that we can just come and lay everything at your feet, Lord. All of our burdens, all of our worries, Lord, all of our struggles. And we just we thank you for your sovereignty, Lord. We thank you for just being a good, kind, loving God that loves us, Lord, and for just thank you for calling us into your family, and we just give you this morning, and it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Please stand for worship.
Within the sorrow, there is beauty in our tears, and you meet us in our mourning with a love that casts out fear. You are working. Sanctifying us when beyond our understanding, you are teaching us to trust. Your plans are still to prosper. You have not forgotten us. You're with us in the fire and the flood. Understand your way, reigning high above the heavens, reaching down in endless grace. You're the lifter of the lowly. You're compassionate and surround and you uphold me, and your promises are my delight. Your plans are still to prosper. You have not forgotten us. You're with us in the fire and the flood. You're faithful. Not forgotten us. You're with us in the fire and the flood. You're faithful forever, perfect in love. You are sovereign over us. Your plans are still to prosper. You have not forgotten us. You're with us in the fire and the flood. You're faithful forever, perfect in love. You are sovereign over us. You're faithful forever, perfect in love. You are sovereign over us. Sovereign God, hold the universe by the power of your word.
Amen, Lord God. We will, Lord, bless your name every day, Lord, all day, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for your sovereignty again, Lord. We thank you for just loving us, Lord, for who we are, despite of our weaknesses and our sinful nature, Lord. We thank you that you cleanse us, Lord. And we just thank you for your righteousness and for your everything that you are to us, Lord. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Amen. Go ahead and have a seat. Church, how are you guys doing? Yeah? Awesome. It's great to see each and every one of you. For those of you tuning in online, welcome. We're so glad you're here. My name is Alex Martinez. I'm the worship leader here at Blaze. And it's just my privilege and honor to be able to say, hey, good morning. How are you? Wake up. Yeah, it's going to be great. So I just have a couple of quick announcements before we get into it this morning. So I just want to let you guys know that construction will be going on sometime this week. The dates and the times are still to be determined, but stay tuned for an announcement on that, either on Realm or through a text message if you're registered through our text messaging service. If not, we can get you that information that you need at the end of the service. The next thing that I want to go over real quick is Convoy of Hope. They're going to be having their event happening at Santa Fe Place Mall. We've been talking about it for the last couple of weeks, and it's happening this Saturday, September 19th, where a whole bunch of churches are actually gathering together to pack and hand out groceries. I would encourage y'all to go ahead and go online to their Eventbrite link, which should be right up there. So if you see convoysantafe.eventbrite, just go right on there. Go ahead and register yourself if you'd like to come and volunteer. Again, I would encourage y'all to just come, be ready to pack, be ready to hand out groceries, be ready to just talk to people. And if you need groceries, if you just need groceries, come on by at 10 a.m. Starting at 10 a.m., we'll start handing those out. So if you want to come on by, just drive on by. We'll get that to you guys. The next little bit here is we have our homeless ministry. We actually feed the homeless every third Sunday of every month. That's coming up this Sunday, September 20th, over at Pete's Place. We definitely need volunteers to help feed, but I would encourage that we actually need volunteers to go and talk and be community to these folks and be able to just sit down with them, pray with them, encourage them. So if you would like to do that and you just show up, basically, at Pete's Place, 11:45 in the morning, this Sunday, September 20th. And if you need more information, Greg Miller's over in the back. Greg, can you raise your hand? There you are. If you guys need any more information, just go ahead and talk to Greg, and he'll get you that. The next thing that I want to talk about briefly is Voter Registration Sunday. So some of you have heard of National Voter Registration Day. Since 2012, that's been happening every fourth Tuesday of September. So kind of what we do with National Voter Registration Sunday is it happens every third Sunday of September every single year. And so what that essentially is that we encourage church engagement in civil government because we believe that it is a responsibility given to us by God in His Word. And so we're not going to be here to tell you who to vote for or what party to vote for or anything like that. We're just going to help you, A, get registered to vote. Second, to encourage you and equip you with biblical values and principles to inform you on your vote. Because, I mean, first and foremost, we are citizens of the kingdom of God. Amen? So I just want you guys to be aware of that. That's going to be happening. Again, we're going to have lots of information there. So feel free to please come. We encourage you guys to come, show up, and get some information on that. The last little bit here, we have our worship and prayer service happening at the state capitol on September 26th. That is a Saturday, starting at 10 a.m. They're going to be meeting at the state capitol stairs on the west side. I just want to just real quick go over these things. It is not a protest or political campaign. It is a time where churches and faith leaders from all over the nation actually are gathering together to intercede, to pray, to repent, and to just pray for our leaders in our nation and the country and the state that they're in. So we're just going to be doing that here. Again, that the dates for that is September 26th, Saturday, 10 a.m., State Capitol stairs. I would just encourage you to be there. Finally, we do not collect a formal tithe or offering. By formal, I mean passing around a plate. We actually leave that between you and the Lord by supplying give boxes, one located over by the sound booth. So if you would like to deposit an offering there, feel free. You can also do it online by going to blazeonline.org, and you can give there. So with that, let me pray for the tithes and offerings, and we'll continue. Father God, thank you so much, Lord, for, again, your generosity, your faithfulness towards your people. Father, I pray now for the tithes and offerings that we're going to collect. Pray that you would use it unto your glory, God, for the spreading of your gospel to this dark world that needs it so badly. God, thank you for Jesus Christ, the ultimate offering, Father, that brought us closer to you, that reconciled us to you. God, thank you that your Spirit now indwells in us, Father, that your Spirit compels us to love with the love of Christ. God, and I pray that we would show you how our gratitude and our thanksgiving now with our tithes and offerings. Thank you, God, for who you are, what you're doing in this church, and it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. So church, now in the spirit of prayer, I would just ask for you to remain seated where you are, encouraged to just pray over these prayer points that we're going to have up here on the screen. Just read through each of those, pray with one another, and let's just pray to the Lord.
Good morning, church. It is great to be with you this morning. If you are new or if you are tuning in perhaps today online for the first time, my name is Vince, one of the pastors here at the church, and it is truly a privilege to share God's word with you today. This morning, we're actually going to be taking a break from our sermon series in Philippians, and even though we're going to be in Philippians in a while, our primary text today is going to be in the book of Romans, chapter 13, so go ahead and grab your Bibles and you can turn there. Last week, Pastor Carlos gave such an amazing message. In fact, if you missed it, I'd encourage you to go back and to listen to it, because it was one of the best teachings I think he has given, and it was so particularly relevant for the times in which we lived. He talked about the sufficiency of the gospel. He talked about how our true enemy is not one another. It's Satan. But he also talked about how we should not be looking to secular movements. We should not be looking to politicians or political parties or any system of government for the redemption that we know is only available through Jesus Christ. Amen? But did you know there's an election coming up? Anybody? Unless you've been living under a rock for the last several months, you know there's an election coming up. We are right in the midst of it. Radio ads, TV ads, everything. And given the fact that we are entrenched in political season, I think that based on some of the conversations we've been having in somewhat of a roundabout way, I thought it was quite appropriate for us today to spend some time talking about the proper role of government and our relationship with the authorities. It's something I've never preached on here at this church. And so the title of this morning's message is Church and State, and we're going to begin in Romans chapter 13. Go ahead and stand with me, if you will, for the reading of God's word. We're going to be looking this morning at the first seven verses. The word of the Lord says, Romans chapter 13, verse 1, let every person be subject to the governing authorities. For there is no authority except from God, and those that exist have been instituted by God. Therefore, whoever resists the authorities resists what God has appointed, and those who resist will incur judgment. For rulers are not a terror to good conduct, but to bad. Would you have no fear of the one who is in authority? Then do what is good, and you will receive his approval. For he is God's servant for your good. But if you do wrong, be afraid. For he does not bear the sword in vain. For he is the servant of God, an avenger who carries out God's wrath on the wrongdoer. Therefore, one must be in subjection, not only to avoid God's wrath, but also for the sake of conscience. For because of this, you also pay taxes, for the authorities are ministers of God, attending to this very thing. Pay to all what is owed to them, taxes to whom taxes are owed, revenue to whom revenue is owed, respect to whom respect is owed, honor to whom honor is owed. This is the word of the Lord. Will you pray with me? Father, we come before you this morning and we thank you for this chance to look at your word. Father, we thank you for the gift of government and for the spiritual authorities that you have put in our lives. But Father, we also thank you that ultimately we are accountable not to them, but primarily to you. And so as we look to your scripture this morning, Father, I pray that we would rest in the fact that we ultimately belong to you and that our citizenship is in heaven. Lord, teach us and through the power of your Holy Spirit, change us. And we pray these things in the precious name of Jesus. Amen and amen. You all can be seated. There are two topics that we are told to avoid at family gatherings. What are they? Politics and religion, right? Politics and religion. In fact, if you want to ruin Thanksgiving this year, ask your family members what they think of whoever it is we just elected. You know, this year it'd been maybe, hey, what are your thoughts on President Trump 4 years ago? Is what do you think about President Obama? A quick way to ruin Thanksgiving. But church here, I would consider this to be a family gathering, wouldn't you? This is a family gathering, and today we're going to talk about both. We're going to talk about faith, and we're going to talk about politics, not because we are a religious or a political church, but because we are a biblical church, and the Bible has lots to say. And one of the things I love the most about this church is we're diverse. We come from different backgrounds, lots of different people. I mean, look around. We would not hang out with each other, can we be honest, if not for this gathering. We have Democrats, we have Republicans, we have Libertarians, we have Independents, we have people who aren't even registered to vote, which is why we're going to try to get that done next Sunday. And I know when I talk about politics, I always get a couple responses as I look to the crowd. Our Fox News folks in here are like, go get them, Pastor. Get them. Meanwhile, our CNN and MSNBC folks are like grabbing their keys and stuff like that. Like, I might need to walk out of here at some point. But listen to me, if you're hoping for a hyper-politically charged sermon this morning, you're going to be disappointed. At the same time, if you're hoping for a politically indifferent sermon, you're also going to be disappointed because on the one hand, the Bible itself is not a political document, nor is it primarily a political platform of any type. On the other hand, many, if not most of the issues that our culture deems to be political are actually biblical. Let me say that again. Many, if not most of the issues that our culture deemed to be political are actually biblical, which should really come as no surprise to us given the fact that God is the sovereign creator over everything in existence, including government. And that's why we begin this morning in Romans chapter 13, the book of Romans written by the Apostle Paul. Paul was a Roman citizen, also a religious leader, early on a heavy persecutor of the church, as we see in the book of Acts. But after his conversion, he became one of the most influential leaders in all of Christian history, writing almost half of our books in the New Testament and about a quarter of its entire content. And here in Romans 13, what Paul does is provide for us the most comprehensive teaching about the purpose and role of government in all of Scripture. And I want you to look back with me now at Romans chapter 13, beginning in verse 1. It says, "Let every person be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except from God, and those that exist have been instituted by God." Stop right there. Now, we'll come back to that first statement in verse 1 in a moment. But for now, I really want to look at that second statement. "For there is no authority except from God, and those that exist have been instituted by God." This is important because before we get into the role of government, it's important for us to recognize where it's come from. What's its source? And according to Scripture, government's from God. It was His idea. Now, as Americans, I know we like to think in terms of a government that is of the people, by the people, and for the people, right? The Gettysburg Address, President Abraham Lincoln. But biblically speaking, in the creational ordinance of Romans chapter 13, government is more appropriately defined as a God-ordained institution of him, by him, and for him. Why is this distinction important? Because here's the deal. If we believe that government was established by us, that government derives its power and its authority primarily from us and exists for us, we will inevitably understand its role to be one which primarily serves us and exists for our benefit versus one that exists for God and serves his glory. And this is why a biblical worldview is critical to understand this proper and limited role of government that we see in Scripture, especially when it comes to our lives as both Christians and citizens. Because the biblical worldview informs us that God is the sovereign creator over all, that Jesus Christ is the sovereign ruler over all of humanity. Therefore, government is not a creation of man, but of God. And in the creative order, government is subservient to a higher and a greater authority, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, Jesus Christ. In short, a biblical worldview helps us keep government in its proper place while honoring the Lord in his rightful place. Absent this, I've seen some troubling things happen. In fact, I've seen this passage of Scripture that we have just read be used to justify actions by our government which certainly do not reflect the will of God. I've seen conservative politicians use Romans 13 to try to justify the separation from children from their families at the southern border. I've seen liberal politicians, meanwhile, use Romans chapter 13 to try and justify the killing of babies in the womb. More recently, Romans 13 has actually been used to justify government-mandated shutdown of churches and restrictions on worship and singing. And so before we move on, I want to make something clear that when Paul speaks of this appeal for our general submission to the authority and power of government, he assumes our absolute submission to the authority and sovereignty of God. Let me say that again. When Paul appeals for our general submission to the authority and power of government, he assumes our absolute submission to the authority and the sovereignty of God. In other words, Paul is not making a case for blanketed submission to the powers that be. In fact, the very same Paul here who preached submission to Caesar in Romans chapter 13 challenged the authority of Caesar elsewhere. For example, let's turn, if you will, this morning to Philippians chapter 1. Philippians chapter 1, take a look at verse 27. It says, "Only let your manner of life be worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come and see you or am absent, I may hear of you that you are standing firm in one spirit, with one mind, striving side by side for the faith of the gospel." Interestingly, only let your manner of life be worthy of the gospel. In the Greek, that statement can also be translated like this: only behave as citizens worthy of the gospel. And I like the word citizens there, because if we now turn to Philippians chapter 3, take a look at verse 20. Philippians 3, verse 20. Actually, let's start for context in verse 17. Paul says, "Brothers, join in imitating me and keep your eyes on those who walk according to the example you have in us." Verse 18. "For many of whom I have often told you and now tell you even with tears walk as enemies of the cross of Christ. Their end is destruction, their God is their belly, and they glory in their shame with minds set on earthly things." Look at verse 20. "But our citizenship is in heaven, and from it we await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ." Do you see the play on words here? We have citizens over in chapter 1. We have citizenship here in chapter 3. And some historical background reveals why this is significant. First of all, Philippi was a proud Roman colony, which means the Philippians were actually given the privilege of being Roman citizens. And though Paul does not condemn their citizenship as Roman citizens, or does he even discourage any form of patriotism, what he does remind them is that their allegiance is foremost in God, not Caesar. He also reminds them that their eternal citizenship is in heaven, not in Rome. And in doing this, Paul is not only discrediting the supremacy of Caesar, he's also undermining the power of Rome by reminding the Philippian Christians that their supreme allegiance belongs to one person only, and that is their Creator God. With that in mind, let's look back at Romans chapter 13. Again, let every person, verse 1, be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except from God, and those that exist have been instituted by God. Verse 2, Therefore, whoever resists the authorities resists what God has appointed, and those who resist will incur judgment. Verse 3, for rulers are not a terror to good conduct, but to bad. Would you have no fear of the one who is in authority? Then do what is good, and you will receive his approval. For he is God's servant for your good, but if you do wrong, be afraid. For he does not bear the sword in vain, for he is the servant of God, an avenger who carries out God's wrath on the wrongdoer. Stop right there. So Paul is doing several things here. First of all, to keep the government from engaging in any form of tyranny, Paul instructs us that government is actually limited by God. Second of all, to keep the people from promoting anarchy, Paul reminds us that the government is actually appointed by God. And finally, to keep the church from fostering a spirit of apathy or indifference, Paul reminds us that government exists as a servant of God. And with that, we get into the substance of these first seven verses of Romans chapter 13, which provide for us the biblical foundation for government's function, the role of the authorities, and our responsibility as citizens. We've already established that government comes from God, and now we can turn our attention to its function. And according to Scripture, according to what the Word of the Lord says, government was established to serve two functions: to promote what is good, and to protect us from what is evil. To promote what is good and to protect us from what is evil. To promote and to protect. Notice again verse 3. For rulers are not a terror to good conduct, but to bad. Would you have no fear of the one who is in authority, then do what is good and you will receive his approval. What this tells us is that generally speaking, government's a blessing. Government is a blessing from God, and I say generally because there are times when God allows evil leaders to reign, right? We see that throughout the Scripture. I think of King Hezekiah. I think of Pharaoh over in Egypt. I think of Nero right here in the days of Paul. But generally speaking, Paul tells us government's a blessing. It's a blessing from God. Without it, anarchy would ensue. Without it, evil would prevail, which is why God does not limit the role of government to simply promoting or even rewarding what is good, but also punishing and protecting us from what is evil. Verse 4, for he is God's servant for your good, but if you do wrong, be afraid. For he does not bear the sword in vain, for he is the servant of God, an avenger who carries out God's wrath on the wrongdoer. Function of government: to protect what is good, to protect us from what is evil. Role of authorities: to serve as God's ministers for good by rewarding what is good and punishing what is evil. Now you may be thinking, well, that's pretty limited. And you know what my answer is? Yes. And amen. It is limited. The power of government is limited. The power of our governing authorities is limited. And not simply by the governed, as our Declaration of Independence would affirm, but by the sovereign Creator who established them and to whom they are accountable. In the book of Daniel chapter 2, it says, blessed be the name of God forever and ever, to whom belong wisdom and might. He changes times and seasons. He removes kings and sets up kings. Who's in control? God's in control. Not only that, speaking of the second coming of Christ, Daniel goes on to say this in verse 44 of Daniel chapter 2. He says, the day is coming when the God of heaven will set up a kingdom that shall never be destroyed, nor shall the kingdom be left to another people. It shall break in pieces all these kingdoms and bring them to an end, and it shall stand forever. Not only is government limited in its power, but the Scripture says there is a day coming when all earthly authority will be conquered by the reign of the eternal King, Jesus Christ. But until such time, government exists for our good. And the authorities are to serve as God's ministers for our good. Now, I use the word ministers there purposefully, because it's important that we recognize that public service is an honorable position. It's important that we see public service as the honorable position it was intended to serve, and not primarily as the disreputable stereotype it now holds. Reminds me of the story of a busload of politicians. They were driving down an old country road when all of a sudden this bus full of politicians ran off the road and crashed into a tree. The farmer, in whose field this bus crashed, witnessed the accident and ran over to investigate it. And what he did next was dig a huge hole, and he buried all the politicians, every single one of them. A few days later, a sheriff was driving by. He saw that there had been a crash, and so he asked the farmer, "Hey, what happened to the bus? And more importantly, where are all the politicians?" And the farmer said, "Well, I buried them. I buried every single one of them." The sheriff then asked, "Well, were they all dead?" And the farmer said, "Well, Sheriff, a few of them said that they were not. But you know them politicians, they lie." Stupid joke. And I'm sure you've heard better ones, because when it comes to stereotypes, the negative reputation of our politicians is probably eclipsed only by lawyers and car salesmen, right? Interesting story. I actually went to college with the intent of becoming a lawyer. I landed up selling cars, and now I'm a pastor, so I don't know where that puts me. But listen, while there are certainly some less than admirable officials out there, we must not forget that this position that they hold, it's an admirable one. In fact, if any of you have a King James Version or New King James Version of the Bible, you'll notice that in verse 4, where mine says he is God's servant, your Bible says he's God's minister. He's God's minister. Now, when I hear minister, I typically think of a pastor or a church leader, right? And interestingly enough, the word minister or servant there in verse 4 is the Greek word diakonos. Diakonos, does that sound familiar? It's where we get the word deacon. It's where we get the word deacon. In fact, it's the same word Paul uses for deacon in 1 Timothy chapter 3 and Philippians 1. And so my question is this: when you think of our elected officials, when you think of those whom God has put in authority, do you see their position with the same respect that you would a pastor or a minister or a leader in the church? More important, do you hold our governing authorities, do you hold our politicians and elected officials to the same high standards as you would a pastor, a minister, or a church leader? You should. You should. Why? Because verse 4, he, speaking of the governing authority, is God's servant. They're God's servants. It's why the scripture commands us to pray for them. It's why later on Paul is going to tell us to give respect and to give honor, because they're God's servants. Now, before we move on, I want to briefly look at what we've read so far in the greater context of Romans, specifically in the context of Paul's words in the second half of chapter 12. You know, it's interesting that before discussing our relationship with the state, Paul first addresses our relationship with one another. And it's important to see that the legal functions of the state contrast with our personal calling as Christians, specifically when it comes to addressing evil and injustice. And interestingly, you can go back and read this later, we don't have time, but you look at Romans chapter 12, verses 14 through 24. To the Christians living in Rome, Paul says some interesting things. He says, "Bless those who persecute you." He says, "Repay no one evil for evil." He says, "If possible, live at peace with everyone." He says, "Never avenge yourself." And he says, "Overcome evil with good." That's our personal call. But within that personal call, God makes it clear that he is at work, that he will repay evil with his wrath, that he will avenge injustice, and that evil can be overcome with good. At which point, it's interesting that Paul immediately moves then to the role of government. Why does he do that? Because one avenue by which God pours out his wrath, one avenue by which God avenges injustice and overcomes evil in society is through government and through the authorities. The Lord says, "Don't personally avenge yourself. I'll do that with the sword of government." He says, "Overcome evil with good. I'll do that through the good of government." And this is important because it reminds us that the role of the church and the role of the government, though they are not completely separate, are in fact unique and distinct. In other words, the role of the church is not the same as the role of the government. The role of the Christian is not the same as the role of the politician or the authority. God did not create church to be government, and God did not create government to be the church. In fact, historically, when church and state have become one and the same, bad things have happened. Bad things have happened. So I'll say it again, the role of the church and the role of the government, though not entirely separate, are in fact unique and distinct. Now, we already know the role of government to promote and reward good, and to punish and to protect us from evil. What about the role of the church? Well, if I had to sum up the role of the church, why not go straight to Jesus and the Great Commission in Matthew 28? All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. So we have church and state, both instituted by God, both servants for God, both operating under the authority of God, and both possessing divine, though limited, authority over individuals. The church over Christians, and the state over its citizens. Now, we've already mentioned limited government some, but I want to emphasize this. This is important. While the state is given some divine authority over God's creation, nothing in Scripture gives the state the authority to restructure or redefine God's creation. Let me say that again. While the state is given some divine authority over God's creation, nothing in the Scripture gives the state authority to restructure or redefine God's creation. In other words, the state's not authorized to redefine marriage. The state is not authorized to redefine human sexuality. The state has no such right to define when they believe that life begins. And the state cannot redetermine what God has already determined to be true and to be moral and to be righteous. When the state attempts to restructure or redefine what God has already created, they are actually operating outside the boundary of their authority. And in such case, the church is then obligated to stand. To stand firm in God's word, to speak truth, and to reject the authority. And we'll come back to that in a moment. Further, while the state is invested with divine authority to rule its citizens, nothing in the Scripture grants the state specific jurisdiction over the church. Again, like the government, the church is instituted by God, but the church doesn't serve under the hand of the state. The church serves under the headship of Jesus Christ. Ephesians chapter 1 says it this way, "And he put all things under his feet and gave him," speaking of Jesus Christ, "as head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all." Colossians chapter 1, "He," speaking of Jesus, "is before all things, and in him all things hold together, and he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have the supremacy." Now, does this mean that the government cannot enforce laws within the church to protect people from harm? No, it doesn't mean that. What it does mean is that the government should not needlessly interfere with the workings of the church. The government should not be interfering with our teachings. The government should not be interfering with our liturgy. Now, you may be thinking, well, Pastor, it sounds like you're saying that there should be a separation of church and state. And biblically speaking, there is. There is. But it's not the discriminatory and hostile separation espoused by atheists and anti-religious groups. It's the healthy and biblical separation established by God when he created these two distinct yet complementary institutions. Because based on what I see in the Scripture, church and government are to operate separately but together. Separately but together. Separately in the sense that they are individually accountable to God and responsible to carry out their specific God-ordained functions, but together in the sense that they are in some ways mutually accountable to one another and responsible to promote the common good of all mankind. Think about it. When you have two separate entities fulfilling their distinct responsibilities but working together toward a common end, we call that cooperation. Cooperation. That's the way I believe God intends church and state to work. And if we think in terms of cooperation, I think it helps us avoid some temptations as Christians. One is the temptation to recklessly conflate or to meld together church and state, which can lead us to idolatry. The other mistake or temptation is to excessively separate church and state, which can lead us to hypocrisy. Think of the person who believes that their Christianity is rooted primarily in their patriotism and how many guns they own and their conservative voting record versus the person who claims to be a Christian but then proceeds to hold positions and vote for people who stand for things contrary to the Word of God. Idolatry on one end, hypocrisy on the other. And as we get back into Romans and some other passages this morning, we'll see that as Christians, we really shouldn't entertain either extreme there. Back in Romans chapter 13, take a look at verse 5. Therefore, one must be in subjection not only to avoid God's wrath, but also for the sake of conscience. For because of this, you also pay taxes for the authorities or ministers of God attending to this very thing. Verse 7, pay to all what is owed them, taxes to whom taxes are owed, revenue to whom revenue is owed, respect to whom respect is owed, honor to whom honor is owed. So we've covered the role of government. We've discussed this separate, though complementary, role of church in relation to the government. Now we begin to visit the relationship between the government and its citizens. And in this context, the relationship between the government and Christian citizens, because that's who Paul is addressing here in Romans chapter 13. And in these verses, Paul tells us that as Christian citizens, we have some responsibility. And he gives three things here in verses 5 through 7. He says, we are to obey civil authority. Get ready for it. We're to pay taxes. And we're to respect and honor all authority. I don't like that. But that's what it says. And there are no conditions here. It doesn't say respect the individual if they are of the same political party or honor them if they're the person that you voted for. It says be obedient, pay taxes, give respect and honor. So let's look at civil obedience for a minute. In verse 1, we saw, let every person be subject to the governing authority. Verse 5 actually reaffirms this, but it also tells us why we have to be in subjection. And it says in verse 5, there are two reasons why we are in subjection. Number 1, to avoid God's wrath. And number 2, for the sake of our conscience. In other words, we don't simply obey the law to avoid getting trouble with God, even though that's a good reason, and that should be the desire of our heart, is that we don't want to disappoint God. But it also says we obey the law and we obey the governing authorities because our conscience tells us that our obedience to them is generally the right thing to do. Generally the right thing to do. Because as we've already established, the power and authority of government is limited, and as the people of God, we're ultimately responsible to a higher authority, to God himself. Meaning we obey government so long as they are operating within their limited God-ordained role. And in 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 13 through 14, the Apostle Peter sums this up very well. He says, be subject for the Lord's sake to every human institution, whether it be to the emperor as supreme or to the governors as sent by him to punish those who do evil and to praise those who do good. When civil authority functions like that, promoting good, punishing evil, the scripture says, be obedient. Be obedient. But here's the problem we face, church. What happens when the government begins to operate outside of its boundary? What happens when the government comes in and tells the church how to do things? Or in some cases, tells us what we can't do, that we cannot sing, that we cannot gather to worship? What happens when, as is the case in other countries, the government actually comes in and says, you can no longer preach the word of God? Or what happens when the government begins to label good as evil, and evil as good? In the state of California, last week, the General Assembly there passed a law to soften restrictions and penalties on adults who have sex with children. Or how about the governor of Virginia? When speaking of a baby who has survived a botched abortion, tries to justify the death of that child after birth, because at that point it's still a right to choose life or death. In such circumstances, as the people of God, we resist. We resist the authority. We disobey and we accept the penalty. When the government forbids us to do something which God commands, or when government commands us to do something which God forbids. Simply put, we disobey government when obedience to government means disobeying God. And we have examples in God's word. So I'm not trying to be a rebel here. I'm not trying to go rogue. We have examples of this in Scripture. In the Old Testament book of Daniel, a king commanded three guys by the name of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego to worship an idol, to which they refused, saying, "We're not going to worship this idol that you have set up for us." There was a penalty for it. They were thrown into the fiery furnace, and you know how the story ends. They don't burn. God saves them because of their obedience to him over their obedience to the king. In the New Testament book of Acts, the Jewish governing authority actually arrest Peter and Paul and command them, "You need to stop speaking and preaching in the name of Jesus Christ." To which they respond, "Sorry, we have to obey God over man." And there's a penalty. They're beat up. They rough them up. But it says that Peter and Paul actually leave rejoicing that they were found worthy to be punished for the sake of the gospel. Elsewhere, the Egyptian midwives disobeyed Pharaoh, sparing the life of Moses. Esther broke the law to go into the presence of the king to plead with him on behalf of her people. Daniel broke the law when he prayed to God after the king issued a decree that no one could pray to anyone except to him. And the wise men disobeyed Herod by refusing to tell him where baby Jesus was. John Calvin said it this way. He said, "If they, speaking of government, command anything against him, God, let us not pay the least regard to it, nor be moved by all the dignity which they possess as magistrates, a dignity to which no injury is done when it is subordinated to the special and truly supreme power of God." And speaking of the supreme power of God, go ahead and turn to Matthew chapter 22. Matthew 22. I said that Romans is the most extensive teaching on government in Scripture, and it is, but I truly believe that Jesus' words here in Matthew 22 are the most significant words that we have on the relationship between the Christian and the state. So take a look at me at verse 15 of Matthew 22. It says, "Then the Pharisees went and plotted how to entangle him in his words. And they sent their disciples to him, along with the Herodians, saying, 'Teacher,'" they're speaking to Jesus, "'we know that you are true and teach the way of God truthfully, and you do not care about anyone else's opinion, for you are not swayed by appearances. Tell us then, what do you think? Is it lawful to pay taxes to Caesar or not?' But Jesus, aware of their malice, said, 'Why put me to the test, you hypocrites? Show me the coin for the tax.' And they brought him a denarius. And Jesus said to them, 'Whose likeness is an inscription is on this?' They said, 'Caesar's.' Then he said to them, 'Therefore, render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's.' When they heard it, they marveled. They left him and went away." So we begin with the Pharisees and the Herodians. These are two religious but hyper-political groups back in Jesus' day, and they're trying to get him in trouble either with the people or the government, preferably both. And this setup centers around the legality of paying taxes. And they ask, "Is it lawful to pay taxes to Caesar or not?" And they ask this question because in their minds, they think they've cornered Jesus into a catch-22 situation, because if he says, "Yes, pay taxes," the Pharisees can then accuse him of being disloyal to the Jewish people. You think the IRS is bad, the tax collectors of Jesus' day were significantly worse. They would exploit people. They would overcharge them. They would overcollect. And so if Jesus says, "Yes, pay taxes," then the Pharisees can step in and say, "You don't care about the people. You don't care about the Jewish people," and that was primarily who was following Jesus at the time. On the other hand, if he says, "No, don't pay taxes," the Herodians, which were loyal to the Roman authority, could then say, "He's guilty of insurrection. You're guilty of treason," and they could have brought a case against him. So imagine that. You have political leaders trying to use Jesus to advance their political agenda. Thankfully, that doesn't happen today at all. And I love Jesus' response in verse 18. He says, "Great questions, beloved friends. Let me answer." No, actually, he's a bit more confrontational than that. He says in verse 18, "Why put me to the test, you hypocrites? Why put me to the test, you hypocrites?" And notice that instead of responding directly to their question, he takes a coin. And he asks them, "Whose face is on this?" And they say, "Well, Caesar's." To To which Jesus responds, "Well, then, render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's." But he doesn't stop there. He says, "And render to God the things that are God's." At which point it says they marvel and they walk away. Why did they marvel? Why did they walk away? Because they knew exactly what Jesus was communicating using this Roman coin. He was saying this coin has Caesar's image on it. It has his stamp. So give it to him. But you must also give to God that which bears his image and his stamp. And who bears the image of God? Who bears his stamp? You do. We do. When Jesus says, render to Caesar what is Caesar's and render to God what is God's, he's saying, give your taxes to Caesar. They belong to him. But you must also give to God what belongs to him, and that's you. All of you. And listen, in a society in which there was virtually no distinction between the political and the divine spheres, this was a truly radical statement. Remember, Caesar, by many, was not only considered to have divine civic authority, he was considered to have divine authority. For many people, Caesar was not only king, he was God. And Jesus steps into this tax debate and communicates some powerful truths. Number one, Caesar's not God. Caesar is not God. You see, by dividing the civic and the divine spheres, Jesus makes it clear that government was not created to be God, nor is government God. Many need to hear that today. Government's not God. But sadly for many, it has become a God. And when this happens, we inevitably land up giving more to Caesar than belongs to Caesar, and we withhold from God what is rightfully his. And that's everything. All of us. Caesar's not God. But in wrapping that statement up the way that Jesus did, he also communicates a second groundbreaking truth in this particular day and age, and something else that we have to keep in mind this morning. Not only is Caesar not God, Caesar's under God. Caesar is under God. As we look at Jesus' response, we may be tempted to picture two completely different and separate spheres. And in one sphere, we have the things that belong to Caesar, and in this other sphere, we have the things that belong to God. But in reality, what Jesus is demonstrating here in this passage is that we have not two completely separate spheres, but a sphere within a sphere. Because that which belongs to Caesar actually belongs to God as well. And though there are two kingdoms, this kingdom of man and this kingdom of God, they're not completely separate, and they're not equal. Before he was crucified, Jesus had to remind the civil authorities of this church, of this particular truth. And if you look back at John chapter 18 and then John chapter 19, it's interesting that Jesus first reminds the civil authority as he's about to be crucified and appearing before Pontius Pilate, he says, "My kingdom is not of this world." Jesus says, "My kingdom is not the same as your kingdom." But the second thing that he reminds them of over in John chapter 19, verses 9 through 11, is he reminds Pontius Pilate that the power of your kingdom actually comes from the ruler of my kingdom. Pilate looks to Jesus and says, do you not know that I have the power to kill you or to set you free? And Jesus says, no. The only power you have comes from above. And as we've already read in the Great Commission in Matthew chapter 28, it says upon Jesus' resurrection that God the Father gave Jesus Christ absolute authority over all. Matthew 28:18, "All authority," Jesus says, "in heaven and on earth has been given to me." Over in Colossians chapter 2, verses 9 through 10, it says, "For in Christ all the fullness of the deity lives in bodily form, and you have been given fullness in Christ, who is the head over every power and every authority." And with those scriptures in mind, let's now talk about citizenship and politics. When it comes to our role as Christians, living, as the scripture would say, as exiles in a foreign land, but also citizens of this homeland, understanding that everything belongs to God and that Christ is sovereign over all is absolutely vital. Especially in the midst of the hyper-politicized time in which we live. Because without that foundation, there are some who are tempted, as we've already said, to make an idol of politics. And how many of you have seen that going on? On the other hand, there are others who are tempted to reject politics altogether. How many of you have seen that going on? And then you have many, even within the church, who try to draw this line between their politics and their faith. How many of you have seen that going on? All three of those scenarios are wrong. They're all wrong. Let's start with idolatry, which we already covered in part. To deify politics, to deify a political party or a platform or any politician is wrong. It's sinful. To put that much hope into any temporary system or person is absolutely wrong, and it's foolish, church. Remember, there's only one God. There's only one eternal King. There's only one ultimate object of our hope. And last time I checked, that position's not on the ballot. That position doesn't get voted on. By the way, if the object of your faith and hope can lose, that's a pretty crummy God. If your God can lose, you know what that makes that God, small g? A loser. Our God's not a loser. This is not, however, a reason to sit this election out or to keep quiet on the pressing issues before us. Because to reject and ignore government, to reject politics altogether, is actually sinful as well. It's the sin of indifference. It's the sin of apathy. Now, I hear this a lot. We should never espouse ultimate allegiance to any political party. Yes and amen. Yes and amen. But we also shouldn't demean or dismiss government as though political indifference is Christ-like or something to be revered. Because it's not. The very fact that God created government basically demonstrates for us that he cares not only about our spiritual well-being in heaven, but also about our physical well-being here on earth. Further, the fact that Christ commanded us to pray that God's will would be done here on earth as it is in heaven indicates that we should be advancing the kingdom of God right here, right now, in every sphere of influence that exists. And whether you want to admit it or not, indifference itself is a position. You are taking a position. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, he's one of my heroes of the faith, German pastor, who spoke out consistently against the evil actions of the Nazis, was ultimately hanged in a Nazi war camp for participating in the plot to take down Hitler. But Bonhoeffer said this. He said, "Silence in the face of evil is itself evil. God will not hold us guiltless. Not to speak is to speak. Not to act is to act." Your indifference says something. Your apathy does something. And as for those who try to draw this line between faith and politics and their who they vote for and their political positions, just beware of hypocrisy. Beware of hypocrisy, because I see this, church. If you claim the name of Christ, if you affirm this word, if you affirm the scripture, but then hold positions that again are in direct contrast to what Christ teaches and what God says is right, that's hypocrisy. Fact, your politics are a reflection of your faith. Your politics are a reflection of your faith. And you may say, "No, Pastor, I keep them separate." And my response is, you can't. You can't keep them separate. If politics were not informed by what we hold to be good, what we believe to be right and true, that separation might be possible. But because our politics clearly reflect what we believe, there's no questioning the fact that your politics are a reflection of your faith. The only question is, are you allowing your faith to shape your politics? Or are you letting your politics shape your faith? Now some will say, "Well, Pastor, you can't legislate morality." How many of you have heard that? You can't legislate morality. And if we're talking in a truly spiritual sense, I agree with you. The passing of laws can't change the heart. But they can restrain evil. They can restrain evil. For example, outlawing slavery, did that permanently end slavery? No, it didn't. But you know what? I'm glad we abolished it. Further, when we use this argument to broadly discourage civic engagement, we also fail to realize a couple things. That every law legislates morality. Every law legislates morality. And every politician, every elected official, every authority, every system of government has some version of morality. Therefore, it's never a question of if we legislate morality. The only question is this: whose morality is being legislated? It's not a matter of if. The question is whose morality is being legislated. Is it the morality of the righteous, or is it the morality of the unrighteous? Because both sides, all sides have a faith. And believe it or not, you don't have to be a Christian to have a church. Those that are sowing unrighteous policies have a faith. They have a church. Proverbs 29, verse 2 says, "When the righteous are in authority, the people rejoice, but when the wicked rule, the people mourn." Church, we should never allow unrighteousness to rule the halls of our homes or churches, nor should we ever allow it to rule the halls of our government. Idolatry, indifference, hypocrisy, I see so much of this in the church today, and if I can be honest, I see it in my own heart. So what's the alternative? If we can't completely meld together church and state, and if we shouldn't completely separate church and state, what then is a good biblical position? And I believe it's what a guy by the name of Dr. Wayne Grudem proposes as significant Christian influence on government. Significant Christian influence on government. And Dr. Grudem, who's a professor over at Phoenix Theological Seminary, says this. He says that Christians should seek to influence civil government according to God's moral standards and God's purposes for government as revealed in the Bible. Again, Christians should seek to influence civil government according to God's moral standards and God's purposes for government as revealed in the Bible. So again, it's not idolatry, it's not indifference, it's not hypocrisy, it's influence. And the scripture provides numerous examples of Christians who not only influenced but actually confronted worldly governments and leaders. Again, the prophet Daniel, he served King Nebuchadnezzar in Babylon while the Jews were in exile. Joseph was elevated basically to the position of prime minister, serving directly under Pharaoh in Egypt. John the Baptist in the New Testament, we know the story. He rebuked Herod to his face for his immoral lifestyle. How about the apostle Paul, who reasoned with the Roman governor Felix on righteousness and truth, is what it says in the scripture, unless we forget, as we've already seen, Jesus Christ himself regularly confronted and regularly engaged with the political leaders of his day. But back to Daniel. You know, it's interesting, whenever I think of our role as Christians here in America, I always gravitate to the book of Daniel. Because in the book of Daniel, you have God's people living as both exiles in a foreign land, but also citizens in Babylon. And the word of the Lord to his people through the prophet Jeremiah is this. In Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 7, the Lord says to his people, "Seek the welfare of the city where I have sent you into exile, and pray to the Lord on its behalf, for in its welfare you will find your welfare." Before that, the Lord actually tells his people, "Build houses, plant gardens, marry, have children." In other words, even though they were in exile, even though Babylon was not their permanent home, God told them, "You have a responsibility to improve and to influence your city." So how do we do that today? Besides general submission to the authority, besides paying our taxes, honoring, respecting, and praying for our leaders, what can we do to influence our city and seek the welfare of our city, state, and nation? We can do two simple things. We can use our voice, and we can use our vote. Our voice and our vote. So let's talk about our voice, because some say that the church and some say that Christians should stay quiet on political issues, right? You ever been told that? Stay out of it? That speaking up on issues like abortion or marriage or sexuality, racism, immigration, poverty, all those hot topics that the government and the media uses to divide us, that we should just stay out of it. It jeopardizes evangelism, church. Don't speak about those things. Just keep everyone happy. Those of you who know me know I got a big problem with that. Because as we've already said, the overwhelming majority of so-called political issues are actually biblical issues. And the scripture tells me that one of our responsibilities as God's people is to preach the truth and to proclaim his word. Further, if the church sees public policy and politics as spheres of influence in which our primary calling is just to keep Christians happy and not rock the boat and keep the peace, you know the message that we're sending? Especially as your pastor, for me to do that, I'd be sending the message that these are spheres in which I don't actually expect you to be faithful. That these are spheres in which I don't expect you to actually follow the Bible and live out the gospel in your life. Abandoning discipleship for the sake of evangelism is not the answer. Nor is abandoning truth for the sake of love. And I've been told this. In fact, another friend of mine, church leader, told me this recently. We were having a political discussion, and he said, Vince, we just need to love people. We just need to love people. And listen to me, I agree with what Pastor Carlos said last week. The most powerful tool that we have as the church is love. I agree with that. But what kind of love are we talking about? What kind of love are we talking about? Because I have to remind people often that Jesus, who was the epitome of love, was still rejected by man and ultimately crucified by the state. Why? Because he spoke truth. He spoke truth. Even though Jesus loved with a love that you and I are incapable of offering, he also spoke truth. He spoke the truth. And listen to me, church. Truth, by its very nature, is divisive. Church, truth, by its very nature, is exclusive. Listen to the words of Jesus. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. It doesn't get more exclusive than that. It's been said that truth without love is brutality, and that love without truth is hypocrisy. But I don't know about you, but love without truth is pretty brutal as well. Love without truth is brutality. Last night, my son was riding his bike, and he's got this horrible habit. He's 3 years old. He'll be four this week. He's got this horrible habit that is he's riding. He's paying attention to things that are happening and not watching actually what's right in front of him. And he was about to literally take his bike straight into the back of a parked car. Now, in that moment, I could have just stood back and said, I love you. That's not what I did. I said, son, look out, you're going to hit that car. I used more colorful language than that I can't say from the pulpit, but I said, look out. In that moment, speaking the truth to him was the most loving thing that I could do. Ephesians 4:25 says, having put away falsehood, let each of you speak the truth with his neighbor. We're not just called to love our neighbor, but to speak the truth with our neighbor. And one of the ways that we can do that is by speaking truth and righteousness into politics and into public policy, because guess what? It impacts our neighbors. But in America, we don't just have a voice, do we? We have a vote. And a vote is a big part of our voice. In a constitutional republic, the ruling power and authority of government has been entrusted in part to us at the ballot box. Each June here in New Mexico and in November. Therefore, we have a responsibility to vote, church. And to vote in accordance, as Grudem says, with God's moral standards and purpose for government as revealed in his word. And listen to me, while there's room for political difference, while there's room for some political diversity in this church, because we have it, we should not and cannot compromise on truth. We can't do that. For example, we can have differing political opinions on the Second Amendment, climate change, foreign policy, education, tax policy. On the other hand, when it comes to issues like abortion or child trafficking, child abuse, there can be no compromise. And I'm just going to say it, and this is probably the most political statement I will say this morning. And some of you may get angry, and that's okay. You can come talk to me after service. I'm happy to continue the conversation. But as Christians, knowing what we know in 2020, under no circumstance should we be supporting or voting for any candidate who supports the killing of babies in the womb. Period. Period. Now, some will say, well, we shouldn't be single-issue voters. Others have told me, well, you must not care about anything else. But those accusations fall flat because if we're honest, every single one of us in here has an issue, don't we? We all have an issue. And come election time, we all rank issues when determining who to vote for. For some of you, it's not the life issue. It's guns. It's taxes. It's immigration. Whatever it is, you have an issue. Mine's life. Mine's life. Because as a Christian whose faith begins with God as creator in the very beginning of this book, preventing the unjust killing of God's most innocent creations tops everything else. And I won't apologize for that. And it's not morally inconsistent or logically conflicting to hold that an act which literally takes the lives of 3,000 babies in the womb each day in America is such a scar on our state and our nation that all other issues become secondary when we vote. Especially here in New Mexico, where a baby in the womb can be legally terminated right up to the moment of birth. Right up to the moment of birth, and it's happening in our backyard. Think about it, church. We have created an industry, and we have supported it with the political infrastructure it needs to carry out the termination of an entire class of human beings. And we claim to love justice? We say justice matters? Proverbs 31:8 says, "Speak up for those who cannot speak for themselves." Unborn children cannot speak for themselves. The poor, the needy, the marginalized of society cannot speak for themselves, but we can speak for them with our own voices and with our votes, which tells us something important about why we should really influence our government, and it's not primarily for our own benefit, but for the benefit of others. Which ties in nicely with Paul's words back in Romans chapter 13 as we begin to close and the worship team comes up. I want you to look at Romans chapter 13, verses 8 through 10. I'm going to read it quickly because we're short on time. After addressing the role of government, Paul says, "Owe no one anything," in verse 8, "except to love each other, for the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. For the commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and any other commandment are summed up in this word, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no wrong to a neighbor, therefore love is the fulfilling of the law." You see, immediately following this call to pay taxes, to pay honor, to pay respect to whom they are owed, Paul says that we actually have a Christian debt that we are never to cease paying. And that's the debt to love each other. You see, the reason that we should engage in public policy and politics and vote in elections is not primarily because of what we read in the first seven verses of Romans chapter 13, but because of what I just read in these two verses. Because influencing government for good is a means of loving our neighbor and ultimately advancing the gospel. And this is where church and state can come together to cooperatively work toward a common end, the flourishing of humanity, spiritually speaking for the church, physically speaking for the government, but also advancing the gospel in an active way for the church and passive for the government. But then Paul reminds us in verse 11 of the day in which we live, and this is the verse we'll close with this morning. "Besides this, you know the time, that the hour has come for you to wake from sleep, for salvation is nearer to us now than when we first believed." Can I get an amen? Paul's encouragement here is don't lose sight of the bigger picture. And that's my encouragement to you all this morning as well. If you're going to be woke to what Paul just said there, that salvation is today closer to us than when we first believed, because Jesus is coming back soon. And the good news is he's already ruling and reigning now. Which means on Wednesday, November 4th, the day after the election, regardless of what happened the night before, these three truths will remain. Jesus will still be on the throne. His gospel will still be true. And the church will persevere. Seek the welfare of our city, state, and nation. Be a good citizen. Pray for your authorities. Use your voice. Vote your faith. Most importantly, share the good news of the gospel. Let's not forget who the main object of our hope is. It's Jesus Christ. Render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, but ultimately rest in this truth, church, that you belong to God. So give to him what is his and rejoice that he's yours, your Lord, your Father, your Savior, your King, now and forever. Amen. During this next song, I'm going to ask you to come forward and to take the prepackaged elements, take them with you back to your seat, hold on to them, and after we sing a song, we'll partake of communion together. Let's worship.
Please stand as we continue in worship.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that He should give His only Son to make a wretch His treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns His face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. Yes, it is finished. Oh, it is finished. Oh, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, His death and resurrection. Why should I gain from His reward? I cannot give an answer, but this paid my ransom. Why should I gain from His reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, His wounds have paid my ransom. Yes, this I know with all my heart, His wounds have paid my ransom.
For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when He was betrayed, took bread, and when He had given thanks, He broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, He also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until He comes. Let's continue in worship.
Thank you. 'cause I know you'll make a way. And I don't always understand, and I don't always get to see, but I will believe it. Yes, I will believe it. 'Cause you make mountains move, you make giants fall, you use songs of praise to shake prison walls, and I will speak to my fear, I will preach to my doubt. 'Cause you were faithful then, you'll be faithful now.
I'm standing. Faithful. They will forever remain faithful, God. Father, that you cannot fail. You will not fail. Father, I pray that we would render our hearts to you in glad submission, knowing that you have us, that you love us. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's sing this next one.
Brain freeze, okay.
It's okay.
Here we go. Yeah, here we go.
For a moment, it's all I've ever known. But this world is not my home. The fight is not my own. These burdens are my future. The empty tomb has shown I am bound for glory.
Our hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. We dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock we stand. All other ground is sinking sand. Say it with me again. All other ground is sinking sand. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. God bless you. We'll see you next Sunday.
Whining like a lunatic, afraid my mind is slipping through my fingertips. I know your good news.